Piper Cleary, welcome to the podcast. You're currently enjoying the thrills of hotel quarantine after enjoying what looked like an epic summer of cricket in England, which I know you've always wanted to do. So now you're back in the hotel, had plenty of time on your hands to reflect on it all. How do you feel about the whole experience?
Thanks for getting me on the podcast. Day 9 of the hotel quarantine now. It's not ideal, I'll be honest, but like you said, I've been looking to get over to England for, well, a couple of years now. Obviously, I was going to go last year and COVID kind of got in the way of that. So to get over this year was awesome. It honestly was like one of the best 6 months that I've had in cricket for a very long time. So it was awesome. And I'm really like looking forward to getting out of here and seeing everyone again there. It's been a long time.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's really pleasing to see how much you've enjoyed it, because I know you said like you've been in WA for a long time. We've pretty much grown up together. And I've heard you say that you found yourself not loving it as much as you'd done in the past. And therefore you wanted to kind of take that year off because you're not contracted with WA in the WNCL this year. So what was it that kind of led to you not loving it as much as you had in the past?
Yeah, and like obviously, like you said, we've grown up together playing cricket, so we've been around for a very long time. So I've been in the same program with the same people for like 9-10 years. So for me, I think it was never like a lack of like loving the actual game of cricket. It was more like it was everything else that came with elite sport. Which is what I was kind of really struggling with, which it was really hard to explain to people like last year how I was actually feeling at the time, because it wasn't like being on the pitch, like playing cricket, being on the pitch was actually fine. It was just like a sense of I was just feeling a bit like empty after the game would finish or, around training and things like that. So having like these last 6 months being away from it all and actually be able to like talk about how I'm feeling and perhaps like why I'm feeling like that was really good. And yeah, it was just all the little things that were just like irritating me, to be honest, like all the off-field stuff that it shouldn't have been irritating me, like, you know what I mean? And that's where I probably had to like look back and go, okay, wow, look, I need to change something here. And to be honest, like I went to England and I played a lot of cricket, like probably played more than what I trained over there. So like without having the off-field stuff, the little things that holding a contract kind of holds you accountable to it too. So going and doing that like has made me realize it was never like actually playing cricket wasn't, I suppose, the issue that was getting me down. It was simply I think just needing a fresh environment, meeting new people, new coaches, and just probably going back on playing cricket because I love playing cricket, and not being like a job.
Yeah, that's brilliant. We have had very similar experiences. And I know we've talked about this in the past with all the other stuff that's around being contracted, in that it's interesting, like, because in some aspect you look at Australia, we're the best cricketing nation in the world in terms of the female game. And what's happened is everyone's like, oh, it's professionalism, they're getting paid, you can train more often, which is absolutely true, but it comes with a whole lot of other stuff and how relevant that is to actually performing on field, and probably more importantly your well-being off field, is the question I've always had. And it's really interesting going back into like dabbling back in. I've played a couple of, whether it's intra-squad games or North versus South or things like that, and at the end of the day it's game cricket. Like, you bowl, you hit the ball, you run around, you have to be fit, you have to be strong, no shit. But, like, at the end of the day, it shouldn't be 9 p.m. and you finish the game of cricket and you have to go and do extra gym work or top-up running or something. Like, all that stuff slowly but surely drains you. And it sounds like you've had a similar experience and you've played a lot of cricket over in the UK. Did your body physically hold up? And with your mind, were you able to actually lock in and give the best of you in that moment, even though you didn't have all the extra stuff?
Like at the start, I had a month off of no cricket before I went over. honest, the first couple of games, my body was like screaming at me. But once I kind of got past, that was just probably like initial pre-season feels that we all have, right? Once I got past that, yeah, like my body was fine. I went through the whole season and I had like one little niggle with my knee. That was about it. So, physically, I was absolutely fine. Like I was still obviously running, gymming, and all that, like away from the cricket. It wasn't someone telling me do this on this time schedule. And then yeah, mentally, it was awesome. Like it's funny. Like, and you would get it when you went over to like Vic. When you join a new team, it's like you. It's not like you're trying to prove yourself to them, but you're trying to show off your best skills to them all the time, right? So it actually maybe brought out the best of me, like at trainings and in games, because I was just giving it everything. Because I was like, right, I'm around new coaches, I'm around new people, I'm trying to prove a point, like to where I should bat, where I should bowl. Like there was no perceptions of me, so it's like I had to give it all. Every time, and like they just love their cricket over there. Like every single game is, and you would know, like having played, like they just play so much cricket, but it's never like a drag. So no, in that aspect, like it was awesome. It was really refreshing, to be honest.
That's brilliant. And the other thing there is that, so they're not fully professional at like Lancashire Thunder level or your Rachel Hayhoe Flint level. There are some contracts. So what was it like training over there, and how did you keep up all of your loads?
Yeah, it's obviously I was living like an hour and a half, 2 hours, depending on traffic from Lancs. So I drive up, I train them once a week, and then I do two other skills sessions in Loughborough, and then I'd go up on the weekends and play. So I was probably training like 3 times a week skills. But yeah, it's funny, they only have 5 contracted players of a squad of like 15. So it's a really strange place they're in. Like obviously I have to start somewhere, but it's really odd like having 5 people that are getting paid, 10 that are not, and they're all expected. Like obviously the hours, people that work, they're a bit more flexible with, but all the hours are kind of, you're expected to do as much as the others. It's a strange dynamic. But the Lancs girls are awesome. Like there's no kind of rift in the team because of it. It's really cool. If anything, it's just like, yeah, like I said, the working hours. The contracted players are sometimes just expected to train in the day a little bit more, where the others can come in later. So I would just join the contracted players, and then stay in a little bit after, particularly at the start to meet some of the like the working girls.
It's interesting because you're still doing the work, but it wasn't you being told when to do it, how to do it, how you should do it. And that impact is crazy, but and how do you actually manage that when you're in a team environment? And did you notice that anything's over in England compared to in Perth or in Australia that they did differently that made it easier? Or do you think it was purely you just being in a new environment?
To be honest, I think it was just me being in a new environment. I suppose that they still had obviously an S&C, a physio, the head coach, and you were still expected to do all these things. It was probably not as intense because they're still finding their feet. But the biggest thing for me, because I only went into their program to play, they were asking a lot of questions like, oh, when do you want to run this week? What running sessions do you want to do? When are you going to gym? Like things like, as opposed to me, like, oh, we need you to do 5 1Ks this session. And do you know what I mean? Like it was very much like an adult to adult relationship, where in the past I felt like it's been a bit adult child relationship, which obviously got better over the years as I got older. But I always felt it was like a little bit like that, where I'm someone like, I really like to be, like have a say in my own program. You know what I mean? Like, particularly as I've gotten older, that's something that it's just how I like to work. Where when I'm constantly probably just nagged, it probably doesn't bring out the best in me. So yeah.
So how do you deal with a coach, and I'm sure you've had a few over the years, that is saying like you got to do this and you got to do it there and we're paying you to be here, because there's a lot of young kids coming through that are kind of walking into this system And not all coaches are like that. Like, as you mentioned, you went over there. Like, I went over to Vic. It was awesome. I've had certainly had experiences in WA where the coaches have been great. It's just you come across a whole lot of different people. But how do you actually deal with it when you do get that person that's telling you what to do, when to do it, and how to do it?
Yeah, I think it's just having just trying to have conversations about it. Like, and I've never really had that with a coach. I wouldn't have thought, like, obviously Bronner's like WA last year, she's like awesome, someone I really get on with. Lisa was pretty similar, like the start was pretty young, so it probably was like great, but as I got older that got better. It's more like I've always probably struggled with the other coaches that come in and try and tell you this, that and everything. But I think it's just having a conversation and being like, look, this is actually how I like to work. Can you maybe explain things better, or can I have a bit of a say in this? And well, like whatever it is. You probably just have to, like, so that's something I got better at. You just have to be open and say how you're feeling, as opposed to just letting it eat at you and not saying anything. And then it becomes a massive thing when it's actually not a massive thing.
Yeah, that's it. And like, I always talk about the noise, and a lot of the athletes like I'm working with now, we constantly spend most of the session talking about dealing with noise. And that noise can come from external, in terms of other coaches, whether it's results, media, if you like, but there's also like how you actually deal with it. And as you mentioned there, like it just starts to slowly build up and up and up and up, and soon something explodes. How do you tend to deal with that noise internally and actually process things to be able to calm down and think a bit more rationally?
I just have to like talk to people about it, like, and sometimes that's really hard because I'm not great at like expressing myself sometimes. But like, I'll go to Amy and I'll just be like, look, this is how I'm feeling, and this is not as much now, but like last year when I was like in a real rut, I would just be like, she'd be like why are these feelings coming on? And I'm just like, I don't know. So it would almost go back to like really basic. I would write it down on a bit of paper and be like, this is how I'm feeling. And then be like, well, these are the pros that, being in this environment makes me feel, and these are the cons. And it's just like starting to actually look it on a bit of paper and say, well, is this actually benefiting my life enough to outweigh these cons anymore? And it got to the point when, like last year, it just wasn't anymore. And yeah, like that was like a really hard thing to do and to finally come out with, because I think that wasn't just like 6 months feeling that way. That was like years. So it was just about time. I was like, no, I've got to do something here. And but thank goodness I did, because I would hate to still be in that place where I'm just feeling so down about cricket all the time. So
Yeah, well, it takes a lot of courage, certainly. Like, I know you love cricket since you were a little kid, playing with Dave in the backyard, and to be able to actually step away from getting paid to do what you should be loving, takes a lot of courage. But when you're in that rut, as you mentioned, how are you able to perform on field? Like, do you reckon it impacted you on field, or was it more an off field, like felt like shit after the game type thing?
yeah, like on the field, to be honest, I felt fine. Like it almost, I've always kind of had the mindset where when I haven't, like it's not caring, but when I haven't actually worried about how, if I do well or not, I've quite often done better in games. So that's kind of a mentality I've always tried to have anyway. Because I feel like when I worry too much about how I do, like it's classic, right? You're never going to do well. So I would always just kind of had that mentality anyway. And then if I did get whacked, it was probably a bit easy because I was like, oh well, like it don't really matter anyway. So no, like on field it was honestly completely fine. It was just after the game I would just be like even after a good win, or if we got absolutely thrashed, I would just feel no emotion,
Yeah,
and
right.
I'd just start feeling like, why am I playing if I don't have any emotion for this whatsoever? And that's kind of how it got to where, when I was in the UK, and this is just because obviously I'd have had time off and I'd probably figure out like what I want to do, who I am, sort of thing. There'd be close games and I'd get this adrenaline through my body again. And I'm like, wow, like it's been so long since I've had that feeling go through my body.
That's brilliant. And that, I swear, every single person comes back to the same thing. It's all the same two things. It's finding out or coming back to that little girl that started playing the game, and or finding out who I am. And quite often it's not like I'm gonna find who I am and be this magical transformative experience. It's just like getting rid of all the shit. So who you are is already there. Like, it's not about finding yourself or like creating yourself. It's just like getting rid of all the other stuff that was potentially getting in the way and stopping you feeling that emotion and that love and that spirit. I like to call it. People get all weird when I say the word spirit or spiritual, but that's kind of what it is. It's just that feeling that comes into it. And speaking of spiritual things, I will never forget this moment. You're the larrikin of the team. Love a few fish and sips, always talking absolute smack all the time. And we were, I can't remember where we were flying to, but we were flying somewhere for a game. I strolled into the airport. You were the first there, sitting up in the like departure lounge, and you're there reading a meditation book. And you had like two other meditation books with you. I was like, what is going on here? Like, I swear you were just talking about sinking some bevs, and now you're here reading like a book about stoicism or something like that. Can you talk me through how you came about with a meditation book in your hand, and if you're still into that sort of stuff, or what kind of impact it had on you?
Yeah, well, I've always tried to get into, to be honest, meditation has never really been my thing. I've given it a good crack. It's not me, but particularly in that stage, I remember reading a lot of books on different, yeah, a bit of spiritual things and reading a lot of books around that and just trying to find, I think honestly, that's when I was just trying to find like my purpose. You know what I mean? I was trying to find something that I could really like link myself to and make a part of me, and because that's always been in there. Like I'm not an overly spiritual person, but I like to think that I can make really meaningful connections with people, and I try to do that. I don't want kind of top level surface conversations with people, if you like I want to take things deeper, and I suppose that was the start when I tried to start reading on things and trying to just figure out maybe where exactly I fit into it all. And I've probably gone down a bit more the route of like hope in the last like year or so. I've read a lot of books like about hope and faith and where I sit within that, and reading a lot on other people's like stories, like people that have gone through a lot of trauma, you know, in their life, whether it's to themselves or their family or whatever, and kind of getting a lot of like gratitude off of that, and realizing what I have been through or is really not bad at all. It's just a game of cricket, like you said. So, yeah, I probably do it like more connections with people and connections with what I'm doing in my life and things like that, as opposed to reading a meditation book now and thinking I'm going to meditate for 5 minutes every day, because that just doesn't work for me. But
Yeah, I was pretty shocked because I'd consider myself one of the nerdier people in the team, and even I don't sit there reading that many medit like you were reading full blown, like deep, epic spiritual texts, and I was like, Piper, what is going on? But that's the process of exploration, isn't it? Like, you've got to find a way, and you've got to, and when you mentioned you're trying to find your purpose, have you got to any sort of point where you're like, all right, this is what I love, this is who I am? Like, can you put that into words just yet?
Well, I don't know if I can put it exactly into like a phrase for you yet. Yeah, so I'm only like 25 and still figuring myself out, I suppose. But I'm very happy with who I am, and for me, like the biggest thing that I've realized over this time is like probably having been away as well has made me realize like my loved ones is just that is the most important thing to me. Like even if I wasn't here with my family and my friends, I was speaking to a lot of people all the time, FaceTiming. And I realized like as long as I have that really good connection with people that I love and like in my life, like everything else will just be okay. Like, and I've realized like sport, like, you know, it's a bit of a cliche, but sport is everything, but it's nothing. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like literally at the end of the day, it doesn't mean anything, but at the time, it is the biggest thing in the world. So, I think I've just probably taken that mentality into things now, and I'm just literally doing things that I enjoy doing and being around good people and people that I can connect with.
That's bloody brilliant. Sport is everything, but it's nothing. And that's it sounds stupid in a way, but it's actually so true. And the part of everything which might help with some clarity is that by throwing yourself into everything and by going deep into something, you start to actually understand who you are. And if you didn't go deep into cricket, for example, cricket's like, because I know we both get along with Viv Paver pretty well, and he talks about cricket being your module for growth. In that it's the thing there that helps us find out all this stuff of what's actually important to us. So, like, connection with the people around you is ideal. Like, that's one of your deep values. Having a good time, enjoying what you're doing, being around good people. But you wouldn't have probably come to that if you didn't go deep into cricket and come into that deeper place, which we call like post-traumatic growth. So when you go through a tough time, when you're in a bit of a rut and you come out on the other side, and that rut may not just be like 1 3-month thing, it can build up over years. And you come out on the other side and have all these insights and perspective on who you are and how you work. And funnily enough, that sort of stuff actually helps you perform better on field anyway. And another thing, like, I know you have had a few setbacks. You had a nasty injury. I remember watching on the boundary. Yeah, I think it was your ankle that went. And the other one that was probably potentially bigger was one that was betting, and it was quite well publicised in that you chucked a cheeky bet, which we all love to do. It was only $15.50, but it happened to be on men's cricket, which is illegal for us to do. And yes, it's illegal, but the powers that be kind of decided to make an example of you, and you got handed down a pretty rough sentence. I think it was 24 months with 18 months suspended. So, like, you were out for 6 months essentially, and you couldn't even play cr club cricket, and you weren't even allowed to go to a cricket ground, were you? Is that right?
Yeah, no, I wasn't allowed to do anything to do with cricket.
And that's pretty much been your life prior to that. So, firstly, how did you find out about this incident, and what was your initial reaction?
Well, I was, well, how old would I have been then? Maybe 19, I think. So it was a little while ago now, but obviously made a bet on a cricket game, which I like, I've sat through all those things before, and I'm like, don't bet on cricket, don't bet on cricket. And then they're like, didn't you listen to any of the meetings we've had? And I was like, no, like I'm just sitting there, I'm not listening. So kind of didn't know at that time I shouldn't have been doing what I was doing until obviously they sat me down and I'm like, oh yeah. And I do remember all that. So basically, like, I think I sent a Snapchat of it actually. And Chloe Paparo was like, at training, she's like, oh, you know, you're not meant to bet on cricket, right? And I was like, what? So that's kind of how it all came out. And then, so we actually went to, I can't remember who went to the locker, but someone at the locker, and just told them, like, that's what I'd done. And it all kind of happened like that. And yeah, it was 6 months of no cricket, which, to be honest, before that time, like, I was lazy. I was unfit. I didn't really care if I played cricket or not. I was just a little bit of a twat, to be honest. And having 6 months out, I kind of thought, oh my goodness, like, I might not get a contract next year. I was like freaking out. So basically went away for 6 months. I got really fit, like compared to where I was. I think I was running like probably close to 10 minutes, if not over 10 minutes, before I left in a 2K. I came back and I ran an 8:40. So I was like just smashing myself running for 6 months. Same in the gym, eating really well. Like, I just basically turned my lifestyle around in 6 months, like at the age of 19, because I was terrified of not getting a contract. So that might have actually been one of the best things that had ever happened to me at that point, because otherwise I probably would have just kept running really slow 2Ks and not really pulled my finger out. So that actually was a bit of a blessing in disguise, I reckon.
What are your thoughts on fear as a motivator? Because we had Beth Mooney on the podcast, and she talked about how she rode 50 kilometres a day Because she was, it was from a dark place. It was like that dark energy. But she said again, same thing. It's the best thing that ever happened to her. And we just saw her play probably one of the best all-time innings when she was cooked. And you could see the difference that fitness makes. And you're similar, and you're like, you smashed yourself for 6 months, but it was almost from a place of fear. But it's also been a good thing. So do you think like fear's always a bad thing, or can it be helpful?
No, I think like particularly in the cases like that, like it can bring out a really great side of you. Like, and I was incredibly motivated. Like, I don't think I've ever been that motivated, like again in my life apart from that time, because I was just so committed to what I was doing. Like, I'd write out my plan for the week. This is when Katie Halsham was about to get in the WA squad at that point. So she would come and probably join like 3 or 4 sessions with me a week. And she also, I think she went from running like a 9:40, 9:50 to like a 9 minute when we went back to training together. So I suppose it was handy having someone else like alongside me as well. But yeah, like it just brought out such a good side of me. And I've spoken to Mooney a lot back, probably not quite when I was 19, more like 21. And she would tell me that she used to run 12 minutes a day. And then she really worked her backside off and got to a point where she's like low eights now, I think. So I think fear can definitely bring out a really good side of you. It's just how you manage it. Like, and with skills, maybe fear isn't the best thing, but with fitness, maybe it is. Like, I don't know the answer, but that's how it's worked for me.
Yeah, that's really interesting, because my next question was going to be, you said, like you said earlier, that you play your best cricket when you don't really care, yet you've come through and said that leading with fear and like actually being super motivated and really caring got your ass together, like got your shit together. But it's again how you manage it. So if you like right now though, because you've had a lot of growth, are you able to be really good at managing how you channel those different emotions?
Yeah, I think so. And obviously when I was like 19, I had no awareness of how I felt and, from a mental point of view and physical, I just went out and did all these things. So whereas I've gotten older, I've realized like fear in skill sense, like in a game, hasn't helped me, because I've sort of like, I just almost lose control of my body, like being able to do things just fluently and with rhythm, like where I found that has helped when I've been on the flip side of that. So yeah, I think it's just managing my emotions as I go. And now fear probably doesn't come into it as much, because yeah, I am older. I probably know a little bit more what I want. But yeah, like you're right. It's just like managing expectations, isn't it?
Absolutely. And speaking of managing expectations, you had the experience of being an overseas player in the 100, which is brings about an entirely new experience. So a lot of people are overseas, or you're going to a new club, as you mentioned, the 100, it's on TV. It seemed like a lot of hype around it. Did you experience any of that fear when you stepped on the field, like you needed to prove yourself? And if so, was that a good thing or a bad thing?
That whole experience was incredible. I'll just say firstly, like obviously being over there, I thought that was just going to be 6 weeks for me, that I would just get back to training, like do some work over there and go watch these games. And then when I got picked up, they're like, "Do you want to play?" I'm like, "Yeah, like absolutely." And like no, I didn't. Obviously the initial thing, I was like, "Oh, okay." We were meant to have like Mooney, Meg, and I think it was Wareham as well, wasn't it? They were their three internationals, right? So I was like, fuck, like I'm, replacing three pretty big names. Like, after I kind of got over that, because there was a lot of domestic players, Aussie domestic players going out to play. So I was like, okay, it's not like it's just me over here. There is a lot of domestic players out here gonna play. And like I got picked up because obviously they had seen me like do well in the domestic stuff there. So I'm like, they know what I can do. It's not like I need to prove myself to anyone. And I guess I didn't do too badly in those games. Like I bowled pretty well. I took a few wickets. I only got really whacked a couple of games. So I think I was feeling really confident in that. And then there wasn't any pressure of like being dropped, because sort of because I'd started quite well. And then obviously being an international player, you just know that you're not going to get dropped unless things go really pear-shaped. And that I think it really works for me. Like, I suppose also, it sounds weird, but I guess people not rely on you, but they probably expect more from you being an overseas player. So, if anything, I think that actually helped me because I felt really valued in that team. So, like, I would always, bowl at the start, bowl at the death, field in the hot spots. Like, and I think it really brought out a good side of me in terms of my cricket. We also had a really good team. Like, the girls were just absolutely awesome. So there was kind of never any pressure like that, to be honest.
So when you talk about having a really good team, what is it that makes that?
There was no egos in this team. Like, everyone was really down to earth. Was even like if someone dropped a dolly in the game, no one ever pointed fingers at them. It was like we go around each other, straight after the game. If you got whacked, people were giving you taps. Like, no one was going, oh my God, like things like that. Like, it was just a really positive team. And maybe because we weren't really expected to do that well, and then we won a couple of games, it was like everyone was on a bit of a high. So, yeah, a little bit of all of that kind of mixed together, and just a lot of good people, I would say.
Sounds like good people is a common theme and everything, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly.
It's when you reflect like this, it's not rocket science. And that, like, be good people, be a good person, surround yourself with good people, work hard, channel your fears, channel your emotions. It's okay to be human and feel like shit sometimes. But in reality, we do come across some tougher teams to be a part of. Whether it's led by coaching staff, whether there's a few big personalities in the team. What are some of the, you don't have to say who the people were or the worst teams that you were involved in, but what were the, some of the elements that have made that on the flip side really difficult for you to perform or be happy?
Yeah, that is a really tricky one. Obviously, we've all, like you and me both, we've been a part of teams where we'd be like, oh my God, there's someone in this team, or whether it's a coach or whatever, that is making this absolute hell. Like, we've all had that experience, right? But I think the biggest thing for me is, like, I generally get on with most people. Like, whether it's a deep connection or not is irrelevant, but I can always have a surface level connection with people. Like, get on with most. I just think when, like, I hate like little bickering in the background. Like, that is the biggest thing for me. And obviously I've been like I've done it in the past, but the past like year, 2 years as I've gotten older, I just don't have time for that anymore. So when I hear it, I just try and ignore it, stay away from it, because as soon as you get involved in that stuff, like, it makes you feel worse when you go. It makes everyone else in that conversation feel bad. Like, it's just nothing good comes out of like little gossip. You know what I mean? Like, and that is just one thing for me. I just don't like it. I think it can cause really like toxic relationships in teams, and I try and stay away from that as much as I can. Apart from that, I've not really had like massive issues in teams before. Just I suppose the little things creep in, which are always going to when you spend a year with each other every year. So it's just trying to like stay on top of that, isn't it? And like you would know yourself, it's like you just have to be strong and like just ignore it and crack on with what you're doing. And it can be really hard sometimes.
Yeah, absolutely. But that is great advice. And I know you have started to get into a little bit of coaching too, in helping the next generation. Is that something you'd like to do after playing? You're not sure. You're also curating, got a whole lot of different things going on.
Yeah, I absolutely love coaching. Like, even just the last couple of years with WA, like when we'd have like younger players come into our squad, I would just absolutely love working with them and just like talking to them, see what they're doing, how they want to be better, if I can give them any like advice on things, or just like just literally talking to them about what they want to do and what I've done in the past. And like, I really have enjoyed that. I did a little bit with the academy as well, the Wacker Academy girls. And that was awesome. Like, I just love being able to work with people that really are like engaging, and not like tell people what to do, but just like talk to them about what they want to do and how they think they're best to get that outcome. Yeah, it's awesome. And obviously I'm still doing like, so sorry. Yeah, I would like to venture down that path, maybe eventually. But yeah, I'm obviously doing the curating for this season, and at Kent Street and Curtin Vic Park. So we'll see how that goes, and yeah, I just see how this what happens in the season, I guess.
Absolutely. And what do you hope the next generation that you're coaching gets right?
I just think, like, to just have freedom, and you always have a choice, like, and like to speak up. Like, obviously, there's so many things I could say, but yeah, I think the biggest thing is just like speak up with how you're feeling or what you want to get out of whether it's a session or skill session, fitness session, whatever it is. Just be free, be who you are, speak up. All these little things, right? Like, they add up.
Absolutely. And you've had a pretty cool period of growth, like since we've known you, since about 14, 15, I reckon. I'm a couple of years older than you, but we grew up together. You were a little shit. But that's what we loved about you. You were the larrikin of the group, always getting everyone up and about. You've clearly grown up, but also hit a little bit of a point where you have fallen out of love with the game. It's allowed you to reflect and grow from that. And have you sort of had any change in how you view success or how you define success since those earlier days compared to now?
I think when I was like a bit younger and kind of like contracts started coming in and all this, I was just so like money driven. I'm like, yeah, I gotta get a contract because I want to make money and just live off cricket and all this. Where I'm just so not money driven whatsoever anymore. Like, I purely just want to be happy. Like, and like I said earlier, around like the people that I've got in my life, like for me that is just a massive thing, because when we're 80 years old, 90 years old, like no one cares about how much money you've got in your bank account. Like, it's the people you've got around you, right? And like, it's so simple and maybe a bit like corny, but it's just literally like success is just who you've got around you and how happy am I? Like, that's all that really matters to me. And I feel like I just feel like I have that again in cricket. And like, I don't know what's going to happen this season, next season, in the future, but I just know that like I stepped away for the 6 months, and I really needed that. And I feel like it's the best thing that I ever did, because I can always get back into cricket, or try get back into cricket and all this stuff. And if I didn't do that, I just would be in a really bad place, I think. And like, I feel successful because I feel happy already.
That's brilliant. That's absolutely brilliant. And the final question for today is, who is Piper at her best?
Who is Piper at her best? Like you said, I'm a bit of a larrikin when I want to be. Like, I'm bubbly, I'm happy, I'm probably going out having a couple of drinks on a Saturday, and then I'm rocking up Monday morning, like ready to train. You know what I mean? Like, I'm really disciplined in the week, and then let my hair down on the weekends, and yeah, have a good time doing it.
Absolutely. And Piper, I actually feel very proud right now seeing how much you've grown and seeing the smile on your face. And I can actually sense it. It's a completely different energy compared to the last time we spoke, was probably in March when I'd say you were really trying to make these hard decisions. And to see how happy you are now, and I'm sure Amy's played a really large role in that, and for you to spend some quality time with her over in England's probably made a huge difference. But I'm super excited to see this next chapter for you and how you go about it, the results on field, but more importantly, you continuing this journey off field.
Thank you, Barbie. It's been a pleasure. It always is a pleasure, but this has been really good. Thank you.
Thanks for tuning in. If you want to continue to be part of the Inside Edge project, hit subscribe or leave a comment below. We're also on all major social media platforms. I look forward to having you along next time.